Hi, everyone. You probably don't know me, but my name is Bash Hallow. I help Dr. Gittleman and his fine crew load a lot of content online. I'm here today with a terrific teacher. Her name is Caroline Gaynor. She also happens to be a very loyal client to Animal Medical. And you come back, you live in the West Coast, but when you come out east, you visit Dr. Gittleman and the crew. Is that correct, Caroline?
Yes, that's very correct. I grew up in the Bronx and I moved out to the Southwest because I love the desert. I love the heat. But I respect Dr. Gittleman's opinion and I value his expertise so much that even though I like my vet here and she's great, I make sure that Dr. Gittleman has the final word about my niblet.
So, but that's not why I have you on. I have you on because Howard shared with me I thought they were just amazing, adorable drawings and computations by your second grade students, because it's my understanding that you use your dog Niblet as a sort of teacher's assistant in the classroom, and you help the students figure out and think about math problems by giving them problems that exist in Niblet's world. Did I get it right? Can you explain a little bit more about that?
That's exactly correct. So I buy treats for Niblet. I buy Niblet dog food. And very often I look at the things that I buy with a mathematical eye. And I want to teach my children to look at the world around them, not just through reader's eyes and writer's eyes, but through mathematician's eyes as well. And so I will bring in a bag of dog food or a bag of treats and I give them problems that I have. For example, how long will this bag of treats last me before I have to get a new bag? What are some things you notice on the outside of the hypo treats? What are the things that you see mathematically? So they'll talk about the weight, the price, how many are in a bag, all those sorts of things.
When I look at these great drawings that these second graders have done, what are you seeing as a teacher that's letting you know that your work with them and this problem that they're solving with Niblet is really turning them on?
Right, because what I see as a teacher is some kids need to draw things out and they need to make actual physical replications of these little actual treats. Some kids use strategies where they've got that mathematical and that computational sense automatically. So some kids take a longer time to get to the answer through picture drawings, and some kids are able to just mathematically computate it in a much quicker way. So I know that there's one picture by Emmy. She was able to quickly say, oh, I could just divide everything by half. And so the strategies that children use to come about is what's so interesting. When we were little growing up, there was always one way to do math, and that was the one way that was taught. Right now, we're teaching children to try different strategies and find the strategy that works best for you. The strategies need to be efficient, they need to be flexible, and they need to be accurate. And that's what excites me most, is that when I look at these children's work, I look for, is it efficient? Do the children have flexibility? Can they use different strategies? But most of all, are they coming up with the right answer at the end? Because at the end of the day, most problems in math just have one right answer. Not all problems, some of them are more open-ended. But in these particular Gittleman questions, there is usually just one right answer.
What is the value that you see of introducing animals to children at a young age?
Empathy, teaching love, teaching empathy and patience and kindness and how to care for something that's so much more helpless than you. Not to get too political, but our world right now is filled with so much hatred that we need to start teaching children young, how do you care for something that's helpless, that you need to take control over, and that you need to respect. It's about respect, basically.
Beautiful. So I want to finish with this. So I said, you know, you're a passionate teacher, you educate other educators. If you had a magic wand to wave over parents of America to make better children in the future, what spell would you cast?
You know, there's a very famous researcher in education that I had the pleasure to work side by side with, Shelley Harwain, and she's talked about how would you rather have your next door neighbor be a good speller or a good humanitarian? And I actually asked my second graders this, and one kid said both. Well, ideally you would want your neighbor to be a better human than a better speller. And so I teach my children And I want my parents to just teach children love and respect for those of you that are different, for different cultures. We have a lot of children in our school with special needs, and to how do we help those children who might not be as able-bodied as you are? And how do we work with others who have less than you, or come from, who eat different foods than you do, or have a different religion than you do? We need to teach tolerance, we need to teach acceptance, and I think everything else then will fall into place.
Thank you so much, Caroline, for taking time with us, and thank you for the great work you're doing. If people need to get in touch with you, your contact information is on the screen. And keep up the great work and keep the pictures coming. We want to see what those second graders are doing with Niblet's calculations of, yes. I think you call the Gittleman's, right?
Oh, Gittleman's, because he's the one that introduced me to those hypo treats. And the kids know Gittleman's. In fact, they're too hard for me to break up sometime. So I ask my kids, who wants to stay in a recess and break up the Gittleman's? And everybody raises their hand. So he's famous here.
That's great. Thank you, Caroline.
Thank you very much.